Major breaking news of the day. Here in the UK, Heathrow Airport has announced it will be closed until midnight local time tonight. This after experiencing a major power outage as a result of a fire at a nearby electrical substation.
On March 20th, 2025, at 11:23 p.m, London Fire Brigade received a call that a transformer was on fire at North Hyde Electrical Substation, a National Grid 275 kV site with 66 kV distribution connections operated by Scottish and Southern Electricity Networks, supplying Heathrow Airport and communities in West London. At around 11:30 p.m, a bright flash and the second busiest airport in the world was plunged into darkness, as their supply had now been cut off and their backup generators were only sufficient for critical safety operations. 62,000 customers lost power immediately and around 120 inbound flights had to be diverted, and over 1,300 flights affected. Heathrow at a standstill. But who's to blame? I've seen comments all over social media that it was Keir Starmer or Ed Miliband, or that Net Zero is to blame, or Putin was seen in the area with a petrol can. I'm not going to speculate on the cause, but I can say for certain none of these were to blame. And we'll explore some of the ways transformers can fail and catch fire. Fast forward to 6:28 a.m, and the thousands of litres of transformer cooling oil that was burning was now under control, and an investigation was underway by multiple agencies. By around 11 a.m, around 5,000 customers were still without power, and by 7 p.m, all affected customers were back online, including Heathrow, which could resume flights thanks to the diligent work of the utility companies to reconfigure the network. So I want to preface this video that the England and Wales transmission network is one of the safest and most reliable in the world, and it's amazing people and engineers who have to respond to incidents like this and resolve the problem no matter how big or complex. I won't be speculating on specifics about the case or investigation. I'm not involved in the investigation, but I have worked in electrical transmission since 2019, all over the UK. So this video is to analyse, educate and demystify, as there's far too much misinformation and politicising a very low probability event that luckily didn't involve any fatalities, but did disrupt millions of lives momentarily and can logically be explained. So let's look at some of the facts to set the scene, some of the potential causes of transformer fires, and ways this type of incident are typically mitigated. A quick history lesson. The electrical transmission network in the UK is called the supergrid, or grid for short, and the big transformers that operate at 132, 275 and 400 kV, the transmission voltages in the UK, are called supergrid transformers, or SGTs. Prior to 2009, the North Hayes site had SGT1 and SGT3, which are the two closest together, with SGT1 being closest to the gate, and in 2009 a new SGT was added at the far end of the site, labelled SGT2. The original two SGTs were manufactured by Hackbridge, which was an old English manufacturer that merged with English Electric in 1965. So if the transformers were still branded Hackbridge, this might give you an idea of their age, but without seeing the nameplate, I can't say for certain. However, there are many cases across the UK transmission and distribution system of amazing pieces of engineering that still stand the test of time today, because it was built to last and maintained by highly skilled engineers. Substation layout. Now, for a quick breakdown of the substation layout to help address some of the concerns people have on resilience, again, just presenting facts. If you look online for the NESO Electricity 10-Year Statement, which I have another video coming soon on, you can find Appendix B, which lists all circuits and transformer capacities on the network. On Sheet 9, we have the circuits, which are cables with a winter rating of 419 MVA capacity, and on Sheet 17, the transformer ratings, and the data that I've found has them at 180 MVA. Peak demand for this node can be found in Appendix G and is only 173 megawatts, which at transmission is roughly the same in MVA. Whilst talking about capacity and load, Heathrow has an estimated load of anywhere between 20 and 60 peak demand MVA. SGT2 at the far end of the site was added in 2009, is also 180 MVA. However, this transformer shares its supply with SGT3 from either substation. Looking at this crudely drawn diagram I made in 5 minutes, shows the 275 kV supplies at the top from either coming into each transformer. 275 kV shown in blue, this then changes to 66 kV shown in purple, orange are circuit breakers, and the small slashes are disconnectors. The substation looks to be a wraparound substation where the main bus bars go around the outside with a reserve bus bar in the middle. This setup lets you more easily reconfigure your substation if some circuits or sections are taken out of service. As you can see, the three SGTs can feed into the substation onto the main or reserve bar. The circuit breaker, labelled 2, is the bus section breaker, which connects main bus bar 1 and main bus bar 2 together. As you can see, one connection to Heathrow is on main 1 and the other on main 2 and can be fed from any transformer. So if any transformer fails, we can close the bus section circuit breaker to connect both main bars and supply both loads. There's many other circuits not shown on this basic drawing which could allow you to connect your main and reserve bars to transfer power even if a section of main or reserve bar was damaged or out of service, giving you a lot of configurations for redundancy. As we know, SGT3 caught fire, damaging SGT1 in the process. However, SGT2 would have still been able to supply the 66kV substation without any interruption to supply downstream. And as we've established, closing the bus section would supply both Heathrow North substations. However, it is likely that due to the fire, the decision was made to isolate the whole site to make it safer for firefighters, and it may be that access to the 66kV site to do any manual inspection and switching was limited. It's common practice to have people on site during switching to check for signs of distress, especially in this substation layout, where you may want to do an on-load changeover, and someone needs to physically check there is a parallel path for current to flow so as to not damage equipment. So looking at the pictures, courtesy of Sky News, we can see it was the second transformer from the gate that caught fire, which is SGT3, and we can see it destroyed the radiator bank and damaged the connected bus bars supplying the 66kV across the road. While we're still focused on this photograph, we can see a lot of blackening on the structures around where the fire was from the carbon in the oil that burned. At bottom centre left of the photo, you can see the three high voltage connections to SGT1, which have been blackened, likely creating a path to earth for the power and causing a short circuit, tripping this transformer out if it wasn't already disconnected from the network by the Transmission Network Control Centre, or TNCC at National Grid, to prevent damage to the equipment and to help isolate the electrical energy from site so that firefighters can do their job in a safer environment. All equipment will need to be inspected, cleaned and tested before returning to service, provided there isn't any additional damage caused, like the control cubicles or the liquid earthing resistor you can just make out between the two transformers, which looks to be damaged. The fire. So we've already covered what didn't cause the fire. Now let's look at what could potentially cause a transformer fire based on reports and industry data from SIGRE, the International Council on Large Electrical Systems. Insulation breakdown. So we've established that transformers are filled with thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, of litres of oil to keep them cool. The oil is also the insulating medium between the high voltage parts, preventing short circuits inside. Transformers also use cellulose insulating paper around their internal windings, which is impregnated by this oil to help prevent it from degrading. Degradation can still occur over time through factors like heat, moisture, and electrical stress, which can make the paper brittle and speed up its degradation. At a certain point, this breakdown of the paper insulation can lead to a loss of dielectric strength, or put plainly, the insulation between the two windings causing a short circuit or arcing, increasing the heating and chance of fire. This arcing also causes the breakdown of the oil inside the transformer, which is a hydrocarbon, and gives off a variety of different flammable gases, depending on the breakdown type, including hydrogen, methane, and acetylene. There are pressure relief devices fitted onto transformers to mitigate this, as well as dissolved gas analysis, or DGA devices, which can analyse the oil for this breakdown and create an alarm back to the control centre, or trip the transformer off the network to prevent further damage. Dissolved gas analysis usually happens in intervals of anywhere from 15 minutes to hourly or more, and isn't fitted to every transformer, especially older ones, where an oil sample is usually taken by bottle and sent off to a lab for analysis. So to help protect the transformer, even without DGA, we use what's called a buckled relay, which can cause an alarm either by detecting the accumulation of gas at a high point in the transformer or through the abnormal flow of oil through the relay, caused by the heating of the oil from an internal fault where the hot oil rises. Buckled relays also have an alarm setting and a trip setting, at which point they will automatically open the load side circuit breaker to take the load off. The transformer oil needs to be regularly reprocessed to remove moisture and contaminants, which can reduce its insulating properties. Another method of detecting an issue with the transformer is the use of winding temperature indicators, or WTIs, which are located in the transformer windings on the LV and HV side, and show the temperature of the winding, which again will rise above normal levels if there's a fault. On older transformers, these might be operated by mercury switches, which turn and make the connection to cause an alarm or trip. Bushing failure is the next common failure for a transformer, and fails in much the same way as the insulation breakdown. Since bushings are also filled with oil, failure causes can be water ingress, internal degradation, partial discharge, and thermal runaway. Winding failure is another form of failure in which short circuits can occur, leading to inter-turn faults, or complete failure, and also caused by thermal aging, mechanical stress from through faults, and poor manufacturing, which can lead to transformers failing in their very first few years of operation, rather than 30 to 50 years later. Another component fitted to transformers that can cause a failure is the tap changer, which allows the transformer to change the voltage it outputs to respond to changing demands on the network. Transformers, as we've discussed, have windings, and taps are different points on that winding that vary the output voltage. To change the tap, a mechanical drive physically moves the tap, diverting the load through a diverter, which can take the load momentarily while the contacts move, reducing the internal arcing that can occur as the contacts are made on the taps. A fault on the tap changer could result in too much arcing, vaporizing the oil and igniting the gas, causing the tank to rupture. Other factors that can cause a transformer fire can include surges, such as from lightning strikes. However, surge arresters and arcing gaps are used to mitigate this, as well as potential issues with cooling fans and oil pumps. However, this would usually cause its own alarm and the transformer would be taken out of service long before a fire could start. A final factor could be incorrectly set or failed protection relays, which didn't act in time to remove the transformer from service, or failed switchgear, such as the circuit breaker, that would disconnect the transformer from the network. However, this is usually planned for, and if the first circuit breaker fails, one further back will act as the backup and still take the transformer off the network. And likewise, backup protection will act if main protection fails. For example, here's a more detailed layout drawing I made showing the cables coming from either 275kV substation to North Hyde 275kV substation. On the left is a key for the symbols I've used, and most assets are labelled to BP109, which is the National Grid procedure for labelling. As you can see, the circuit breakers on the 66kV or low voltage side aren't shown in this diagram, as they're in the 66kV substation. Regardless if they acted or not, if they're unable to clear the fault, then for SGT3, the next circuit breaker upstream would trip, which is L85 at either substation. This would stop providing power on the either 12 cable, meaning SGT2 would have to rely on its supply from either 11. Due to the fire either tripping SGT1 or because of the control center, either 11 also needed to be isolated, which meant tripping L45 back at either, thus de-energising the whole substation to make it safe for firefighting. Transformers are some of the most expensive assets that can take years to procure and months to install and commission. We do everything we can to protect them. So I'll not speculate on what caused the fire at North Hayes, but these are some of the typical causes of a transformer fire, and I've explained which ones are less likely than others, so now you can be more informed on the topic. One thing is for certain, we won't know for sure until all investigations are complete and a report is issued. Now let's take a look at some fire mitigation that could have made the difference to the extent of the impact. Fire mitigation. The first thing that caught my eye when looking at the pictures on Sky News was the red pipework. You can still see the pipework around the transformer that burned too. This pipework is what's known as a transformer fire deluge system, which is pipework and sprinklers surrounding the transformer that, when a fire is detected, drenches the transformer in water to extinguish a potential fire. It's hard to tell from the pictures if this activated or not, however the foam you can see in the pictures will be from the firefighters using foam to smother the oil-based fire. A fire deluge system not activating could be because it was redundant, locked out due to maintenance or safety concerns, had water supply issues, or had a failure of a valve or a blockage in a pipe, among many other things. The second thing I noticed, which is common for transformers located so close together, is the lack of a blast wall, which is a large reinforced concrete structure or brick designed to reduce the impact of a fire or explosion on nearby equipment. In this case, it might have been enough to prevent lasting damage to the other transformer, leading to further loss of electricity supply to customers. However, when these transformers were installed, probably over 60 years ago, the importance of the supply might not have been as high, or the inclusion of the fire deluge system might have reduced the risks of the fire sufficiently to not need one. Summary. All of the information in this video is publicly available and interpreted by myself as someone in the industry but not familiar with the site or details of the investigation. It'll be a while before we know more concrete information, but one thing I'm certain of is this was a regular fault that can occur on any equipment and was not the act of sabotage like a lot of people want to believe. I hope this video was informative and educational, and I'll be producing more videos in the future on all things industrial history and electrical theory, explaining how different components of a substation work, and commenting on past, current and future projects in the UK. Thanks for watching, and make sure to share this video to help inform others, and subscribe for more electrical content. And if you're interested in a career in maintaining and designing these critical important assets, there's an industry-wide shortage of engineers in the UK. So look online for careers and apprenticeships with your local transmission operator, distribution network operator, or in the supply chain. Take care.